I changed the talk for the sermon this morning. It was supposed to be the Spirit of Rome that was on the card, but I just felt really strongly to share this message instead, and it's called, What's the Big Deal? Come on. There's so many things that we get into a position where we start, as it were, down a mountain, and we start on a slide where we start to say, well, this doesn't make any difference. And who cares about that anymore? It really doesn't matter. Well, I'd like to take a look at some things with you this morning that do matter. And they are important. And we need to refocus. We need to refocus again on what is important. As Bud was talking about, you know, in our world today, you can walk into any church and you can see, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 different Bible translations. And you can get up and you can have a minister talking from, say, the New International Version, which mine is not. Mine is the King James Bible. And you can have somebody in the class or in the church. One has a revised version, one has a New International, one has a New King James, one has the King James, one has Good News, one has the Jerusalem, and it goes on and on and on. Well, it, you know, people say it doesn't make any difference what Bible you use. You can use the NIV, the Good News, the New American Standard, the New King James. They're all the same. Well, you're right. These are all the same. These are all the same. You notice the New King James Version. When it was written, people said, well, it was written just to get rid of those archaic these and thous. Well, folk, it went a whole lot beyond that. And if you notice an interesting symbol here, you see this symbol? What is that, June? Wicket. Okay, Wiccan. Okay. Look at this. Is that the same symbol? Same symbol, isn't it? And this is on the cover of the Aquarian conspiracy. This lady knows there's a conspiracy going on. She's not afraid to say it in her book. The Aquarian conspiracy. There was that rock group in the 60s. It said, we're dawning to the age of Aquarius. You remember that song? Yeah. This was the symbol of the age of Aquarius. And the New King James Bible has the same symbol. Same symbol. It went a whole lot beyond getting rid of the these and thous, folk. The symbolism of the Aquarian conspiracy and the New King James Version of the Bible is identical. This Bible, along with all others, except for one, are based around corrupted manuscripts that are steeped in allegory, mysticism, and corruption of the pure Word of God. Now, Bud was reading from this book, Our Authorized Bible Vindicated, and he had some excellent little flyers in that other book, The New King James Version Exposed. Folk, there are two streams of Bible translations. There are two streams. One stream starts over here with Origen, who was an Alexandrian father in the 3rd and 4th century. It goes from there to Jerome and the Latin Bible. From there it goes to the Vaticanus Sinaiticus. And those are all in one stream. And then they come down to the Jesuit Bible called the Reims Version, which was published in 1582. And then you come down, you follow the stream, and you come down to the Revised Version in 1881. And from there you have all the other modern translations all the way down to the New King James Version of the Bible. They're all in that one stream right there. And they're all corrupted. They all came from corrupt manuscripts. Over here on this side, you have from the received text, you have 5,000 manuscripts throughout the world that all say the exact same thing. And it was from those manuscripts from the received text that a scholar in the 16th century, his name was Erasmus of Rotterdam. He translated the Bible into the Greek New Testament. And from there, you have the King James Version of the Bible. Folk, that is the other stream. This stream over here, it's corrupted. This stream is the one true stream from God. It's on this side with the King James Version of the Bible. Listen to what this man says. His name is David Otis Fuller. He said this, listen carefully, the only version of the Bible out of the 100 versions on the market that is founded on the Textus Receptus is the King James Version. And this Greek text agrees with over 5,000 extant Greek manuscripts in the world today of the New Testament, in part or nearly in whole, in between 90 and 95%. While the Westcott and Hort Greek text, on which all the modern versions are founded, disagrees with these same 5,000 Greek manuscripts, the same percentage, 90 to 95%. What was wrong with the revised version of 1881 where all the mischief began? It was based upon the Westcott and Hort Greek text. And that was based upon two of the worst manuscripts ever discovered, the Codex Vaticanus and the Codex Sinaiticus. Vaticanus, or B, is in the Vatican Museum in Rome. All of Revelation is missing in this manuscript. 46 chapters of Genesis, 30 Psalms, all of the pastoral epistles, and Hebrews chapters 9 through 13. Now, this is taken from Hector McPherson's book called The Jesuits in History. I quoted in my book, The Secret Terrorist. It's printed from Ozark Book Publishers, 1997. McPherson said, in 1825, 11 years after the revival of the Jesuit order, a secret meeting of leading Jesuits was held at their College of Chartres near Turin in northern Italy. At that gathering, plans were discussed for the advancement of papal power worldwide, for the destabilizing of governments who stood in the way, and for the crushing of all opposition to Jesuit schemes and ambitions. What we aim at is the empire of the world. We must give them, the great men of the earth, to understand that the cause of evil, the bad leaven, will remain as long as Protestantism shall exist, that Protestantism must therefore be utterly abolished. Heretics are the enemies that we are bound to exterminate. Now that's in the Jesuit oath. The Jesuit oath has one intent. That is to destroy every single person that claims to be a Protestant. You know, folk, bless those dear Methodist people here in Chino Valley. Bless their hearts. They felt that as they were connected with the mailing of the Secret Terrorist book this over the last few weeks, that it was connecting them. And so in their desire to apologize to the Catholic Church, they said, Pete, you can no longer worship here, because you're connected with this Bill Hughes and this hate literature of the secret terrorists. Folk, what the Methodist Church doesn't understand is that at Vatican II, from 1962 to 1965, the Catholic Church said, what we are going to do, We are going to befriend all of the Protestant churches. We're going to say that we're all brethren. We're all one together again. You know why they're doing that, folks? So that the Protestant churches of today can say, oh, the Catholics, they're our brothers in Christ. They're Christians just like we are. What's that, June? That's exactly right, June. To throw Protestants off their guard so that one day the Catholic Church will come in and you know what they'll do to the Protestants of this world? Kill them. Kill them. Kill them. Anne. Sure, sure.
And it has a foreword somewhere in there with the Pope saying stuff.
Oh, sure, sure, yeah. Sure, Anne.
I don't know.
Folk, when we don't learn the lessons of history, we're doomed to repeat them and bear the fruits of our ignorance. You see, in France, in the 1550s, 60s, and 70s, there was a group of people in France called the Huguenots, or the Huguenots. And the Huguenots stood for the Bible. They stood for what the Bible taught. The Catholic Church in France hated the Huguenots. So what Catherine de' Medici said to the Catholic priest, she said, look it, we're going to create a wedding between a Catholic princess and a Protestant prince. And we're going to unite Protestants and Huguenots together. So they had a wedding in 1572. I think it was in August of 1572. 3 days after the wedding, all the Protestant Huguenots had come to Paris for the wedding. Oh, everybody was so happy, the Protestants and Catholics, they're all together, they're all brothers and sisters, oh good. 3 days after the wedding, there was a bell that rang at midnight. And for the next weeks, several weeks throughout France, there was what is known in history as the St. Bartholomew's Massacre. Huguenots' blood ran like water through the streets of Paris. 70,000 Huguenots died in Paris. 70,000 in Paris alone. That was the result of uniting Protestants with Catholics. So, folk, if there's any Methodists here today, there's any Methodists here today, or you have friends in Chino Valley that are Methodists, friends, go to them and say, have you not read the pages of history? Do you not know what the Catholic Church does when you kowtow to them? And you say, oh, I'm sorry. We didn't mean to hurt your feelings. We didn't mean to expose you as the Antichrist. When you apologize, give them a while, and they will turn, and they will massacre you. Because that's what they did to the Huguenots in 1572. Now, folk, I understand that some of you may be saying, you know, that kind of makes me uncomfortable to think that I could be in my home, and all of a sudden, some dragonades of Rome could beat down my doors and smash my windows, rape my wife, kill my children, and then slaughter me. And you say, I don't like to hear that. Well, you know what, folk? Wake up, because that's reality. That's reality. Hitler did it, June. Mussolini did it in Italy. Mao Zedong did it in China. And somebody may say, oh, but Mao Zedong, he was a communist. Yeah. Mao Zedong was a communist. But you know what? Mao Zedong worked for a hospital in China before he became a communist leader. And guess who owned the hospital where he worked? It was people that were a part of Yale University's Skull and Bones. And Mao Zedong was sold out. He sold his soul to the Jesuit order and the Pope. And Mao Zedong, under the dictation of the Pope and the Jesuit general, slaughtered millions of Chinese people. Millions of Chinese people. And the dear lady, June, that I was talking to on the phone today, she asked me, she said, "Do you believe in the pre- or the post-trib rapture?" And when I told her, I said, "Ma'am," I said, "we're living in Disneyland if we think that persecution is not going to come to people that stand up for truth today. We're living in Disneyland. We think it's all Mickey Mouse and Matterhorn and let's have a good time because we're going to be raptured out of this place before Jesus comes. And we won't have any trials or any persecution." Well, think again. Amen. Think again. Because the same people that controlled Mao Zedong and Stalin and Lenin and Khrushchev, they controlled Bush, both Bushes, Clinton, they control the current president of the United States. And the only reason that we still live in freedom today is because the God of heaven realizes this is still the cradle of liberty. What's left of liberty, it still is in America. But folk, if we're not about our Father's business and spreading the truth for this time and waking people up, we're playing games. We're playing a circus. We're playing Disneyland. And those games are going to end because Rome is not playing a game. As you saw with this, you know, all these letters about this hateful Bill Hughes, folks, I would imagine the Methodist Church probably got phone calls from probably 3 or 4 Roman Catholics that went to their priest, and the priest said, "Now look it, we're going to make a schedule. And at 9 o'clock on this day and on this day and this day, you call them. And you say how awful that literature was and how evil that guy was. And then on this day and this day and this day at this time, you call them and you say the same thing." So there were probably about 3 or 4 slaves of the local Catholic priest who made all of the calls. Folk, they know what they're doing. They want to exterminate Protestantism. They don't want anybody to protest. So they invent TVs and they invent fast foods and they invent all these different Bibles, anything to make our brains like mashed potatoes. Anything so that we'll stop protesting. Well, folk, if we are truly Protestants, if we are truly Protestants, every single Protestant of the 16th, 17th, 18th century, they knew who the Antichrist was. There was no confusion in their mind. They knew it was Rome. And they stood up at the risk of their life to declare that truth. So here the Jesuits at Cherie in 1825, they say, "We're going to exterminate those Protestants." And then they say here, "The Bible, that serpent." Now, what Bible was it that the Jesuit order called a serpent that they so hated because it was the Protestant Bible? It was the Bible in England that was the fruit of the Protestant Reformation in England. What Bible was it? It was the King James Version of the Bible. And the Jesuits say it's a serpent which, with head erect and eyes flashing, threatens us with its venom while it trails along the ground. We're going to change it into a rod as soon as we are able to seize it. And so how did they change it? Well, they got Westcott and Hort, and they created 100 new Bible translations to create confusion in churches, Protestant churches the world over. You name the Protestant church, there's confusion. Isn't there? Confusion. Well, how about dress? We say, it doesn't make any difference how we dress. I can dress however I want to. God loves me just the way I am. Sure he does. Sure he loves us just the way we are. And he accepts us just the way we are. But does God want us to stay there? You know, folk, when I became a Christian, something happened to me. Something changed in me. And I remember going off to college. And I remember the teachers getting up in classes and telling us theology majors. They'd say, "Gentlemen, God loves you. And he doesn't care how you live, how you dress, what you eat. Makes no difference at all. God loves you. And you're going to keep right on doing evil till Jesus comes. So just have a good time in this world." Now, folk, I came from that. I came from garbage. I came from immorality and pot and alcohol. I came from that. And by the grace of God, was delivered from that and was not going back. Are these things important to heaven? You bet they are. And we need to take them seriously and quit thinking that, oh, just because God loves me, I can do whatever I want, whenever I want, however I want. That's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Folk walking into churches, you say, "Bill, you're picking on women." No, this is about men too. We've all got to think about how we dress, what message we send by the clothes that we wear. What message do we send? Low-cut dresses, mini skirts, bare backs, tight pants, you name it, we've compromised so far in our dress, it stinks. It's important how we dress. Listen to 1 Timothy 2, 9 and 10. Paul said, "In like manner." Now, Paul mentioned the women. You know, it's interesting how the Bible mentions and focuses on women. You know why I think it does? Because women and men are programmed differently. Women are not attracted, per se, to a hulking man. You know, they're not attracted to the physical appearance. They're attracted to emotional or to tenderness, to kindness. Is that not true, ladies? That's what the women are attracted to. But men, what are men attracted to? They're attracted to what a woman looks like. That's what men are attracted to. So that's why in the Bible, Paul says, "Women, you better make sure what message you're sending by how you're dressed." Folk, this is serious. You look at the stories in Scripture. Think of the stories in the Bible. David. When you think of David, what is the one story in the Bible that you think of when you think of David? What story is it?
Bathsheba.
You mean it's not the one where David fought Goliath? Or it's not the one where David became king? Or it's not the one when David had to flee from Absalom? Or when David died? No. Bathsheba and David. That's the one you remember. David fell. Bathsheba was taking a bath. And the king had view of Jerusalem. Now, if the roles had been reversed, and Bathsheba was queen, and David was a commoner, and she had seen David, she would have been repulsed because she would not have been attracted to David physically. David fell, Samson fell, Solomon fell, and the list could go on and on and on. Is it important, women? Is it important how we dress? Is it? What message do you send? What message? Do you send the message of, I'm fair game. I'm ready to sleep with you. Is that the message you send by how you dress? Come on. It's serious, folk. Men's lives are destroyed because of immodesty. Amen. It's important. And we send a message. We send a message every time we put clothes on. We send a message. Paul says, women adorn themselves in modest apparel. Modest apparel. Cover yourself. Be covered with shamefacedness and sobriety. Not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. Peter said the same thing. Whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair, wearing of gold, or putting on of apparel. But let it be the hidden man of the heart, and that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. How important it is how we dress. How important it is what we eat, when we eat, how much we eat, when we sleep, how much we sleep. When we exercise, how much we exercise, do we exercise? You say, wait a minute, I thought I came to hear from about the secret terrorist book. Guy's not talking about that anymore. He's gone to meddling. He's meddling in my private affairs. Please, get on. I was enjoying the history, but this stuff, this is hitting too close. Folk, it's important. It's important what we eat, how much we eat, when we eat. It affects this, doesn't it? It affects this right here. And this is where the war goes on, right here. Every time I eat, every time you eat, you start to feel a little groggy, like you want to rest. That's why the afternoon meeting, right after lunch on Sabbath, it's always the toughest meeting, isn't it? Because you start to go, oh, that was a great lunch, but I'm ready to take a snooze. Why? Because the blood has gone from your brain to your stomach to help digest the food. Well, if I'm eating at 7 in the morning and 10 in the morning and 12 at noon and then 3 and then 5 and then 8 at night. What do you think's going on to my brain by the time I'm ready to go to bed? Folk, I'm exhausted. And how much do you think's getting on through there? Do you think I'm going to feel like reading a book? No. I'm going to feel like just going, turn on the television and let me just stare at it. Aren't we? Come on, be serious with yourself. That's what we feel like. And then what happens? What happens if I eat? You know, I've eaten a dinner, and dinner should not be a big meal. If you got to eat at night, eat a small meal like some fruit and cereal or you know, some toast and fruit. But don't make it big. Why? Because, folk, if you go to bed a few hours later, what's your stomach still doing while you're trying to sleep? It's still working. It's still working. And so you're fretful through the night and you can't sleep and you have nightmares and you're dreaming. And then you get up the next morning and you just go, did I just sleep? You feel exhausted. And the reason why? Because your body's been working when it's supposed to have been resting. And then, in that frame of mind, you kneel down to pray. And what happens? What happens? You can't get up! Ma'am, you're an honest soul. You've gone to sleep, haven't you? And then you get up and you go, boy, what did I just pray? And then, after you've slept through your prayer, you open your Bible to read, and what happens then? You go to sleep. And after 20 minutes, you close your Bible and you say, this has got to be the most boring book I have ever seen in my life. Is it the Bible's fault that you think the Bible is now boring? Is it the Bible's fault? No, it's your fault. It's my fault. Because we have been intemperate. We have eaten too big a meal too late at night, and we blame it on God. We say, why did you write such a boring book? And it's our fault. It's our fault. And some of us sleep all hours of the night. And some of us don't know what exercise is. For some people, exercise is a bad word. And for some of us, getting to bed at a reasonable hour of night, and I'm talking about 9:30 at night, to some of us, that's a bad word. Because we want to sleep 1-2 in the morning. You can't do that. If I stood here today and had a glass of anything and I started pouring it into my computer, or I took some peanut butter and I started going like this through my computer and started, you know, took out the console and started doing that on my machine here, and all of a sudden, it didn't work as well. Now, whose fault is that? Do I take the machine back to Epson and say, you gave me a faulty machine? It's not Epson's fault. It's not Vista's fault. It's my fault. It's my fault. And it's time, it's past time, that we took some responsibility for our stinky decisions. You know, we can play. We can play with people. Do you think God is mocked? Do you think God is deceived by our foolishness? by the dumb things we do. You know, it's like people that get skin cancer. I've got some relatives that have skin cancer, and they say, well, the skin cancer was caused because of the ultraviolet rays of the sun. And so it's God's fault. God, you made the sunlight, and the sunlight gave me skin cancer. So God, you caused me to have skin cancer. So God is the one at fault. The creator of the universe who made the sun and made the human body didn't know it well enough. He's the one who causes skin cancer. Baloney. Baloney. The reason people get skin cancer is because they eat flesh food, and the oil in flesh food cannot be digested by the human body, which was never made to eat flesh food. You put a finger on your teeth, I don't feel any sharp teeth there, because I was not made to tear food. I was made to grind it. I was made to eat grain and nuts and vegetables and fruits. That's what my teeth tell me. I don't have teeth like a lion, do you? Lions were made to tear flesh. They've got the teeth to do it. You weren't. You weren't. These are all important, folks. Our eating habits are important. Our sleeping habits are important. Our exercising is important, because they all have an effect on this incredible computer right here. Right here. You show me somebody that sleeps at 2 or 3 in the morning or midnight, I will show you somebody that it is impossible for them to have patience. Impossible to be patient! Why do you think people get road rage? Why do you think people use all kinds of finger gestures when you simply forget to blow your horn or to put on your signal? Why? Because they are not sleeping right, they are not eating right, they are not exercising right, therefore they are not thinking right either. It does not take a rocket scientist to figure out why America is in the condition it's in. This is important, folk, and we got to get serious about what we eat, when we eat, how much we eat, our sleeping habits, and our exercise. Here is another thing. We talked about it this morning. People are getting so confused about who the Antichrist is in the world today. Anybody that points out who the Antichrist power is of Scripture, that it's the papacy, it was the papacy, it is the papacy, and it will always be the papacy. It's not Islam, it never was Islam, it never will be Islam. But there is mass confusion in our world today. Mass confusion. In every church throughout the world. Here's a famous doctor of theology. Shame on doctors of theology. But he said the Antichrist is the papacy and Islam. And he said that's the little horn of Daniel chapter 7. And that is absolute garbage. Here's another man. These are Seventh-day Adventists, but this has been going on in every church throughout the world. I remember giving some meetings in Goldendale, Washington a few years ago, and we were talking about the Antichrist in Revelation 17, and I was going through all the characteristics. They claim to be God. They claim they can forgive sins. They persecute people that don't go along with them. They've changed the law of God from the seventh-day Sabbath to the first day of the week, Sunday. They reside in the Mediterranean world. And the name of their church is also the name of a major city in the world. And as I'm going down, one characteristic after another, there's a guy sitting right there, Pete, where you are. And as I'm going through the characteristics, he starts to smile. And his smile gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Till finally I said, "Folk, who is the Antichrist of Scripture?" And the man, and I said, "It's the Roman Catholic Church system. It always has been, it is today, and it will be." And after the meetings, this man walked up to me and he said, "Son," he said, "I've been a Baptist for 40 years. 40 years. He said, "When I first became a Baptist 40 years ago," he said, "people, Baptist preachers, preach just like you did this afternoon." I said, "And what do they do today?" He said, "I haven't heard a message like what you preached in 25 years in the Baptist church. 25 years! Every single church, no matter what church you attend, your church is starting to tell you that the Antichrist is Islam or, maybe the Bilderbergers or the Masons or, you know, all these other groups. But they will not tell you that it is the system of Roman Catholicism. They won't tell you that. The Antichrist power of Scripture, the little horn in Daniel chapter 7. He's identified as the king of the north in Daniel chapter 11. He's identified as the man of sin in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. He's identified as Jezebel in Revelation chapter 2. He's identified as the first beast of Revelation chapter 13. Identified as the harlot of Revelation chapter 17. These all identify the same Antichrist power, the papacy. Now I know I mentioned this letter already, but I want to mention it again. This dear man in Chino Valley. "Dear Methodist people, I've never written a letter like this before, and after 65 years, I didn't think anything could shock me. Then I opened my mailbox about midweek and have never felt so violated in my life. I'm absolutely appalled that an institution of such high regard..." Now I'm going to put in parentheses there. But see, this man doesn't understand that. But this church that he has such high regard for as the Methodist Church is the one that his church, Roman Catholicism, is planning to massacre in the future. Okay. Would be sponsoring Bill Hughes' vitriolic and downright hateful book, The Secret Terrorist. Where in your theology does this despicable venom sit? Well, you know where it sits? It sits in the Word of God. That's where it sits. That what he calls venom is the truth of God. What he says comes from the devil or is evil is in Scripture. If he wants to accuse me, then he better be ready to go after the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, and God the Father. How hateful the Bible is. I mean, the Bible must be hateful because look at how many times, 6 times it identifies the papacy in symbol in Scripture. So based on what I've read in letters from folk here in Chino Valley, the Bible must be hateful too. Well, folk, give the papacy time. Give the papacy time. And there will be a burn the King James Version of the Bible day throughout the world. Mark my words. Mark my words. Who is so hateful, vicious, cunning, and treacherous? Those who originated communism that has murdered billions of people? Folk, if you want to go back and do some research, I didn't bring the books with me. But if anybody is interested in doing the research, Adam Weishaupt was teaching. He was a Jesuit professor at Ingolstadt University in Bavaria, Germany in the 1760s and 70s. Adam Weishaupt created the Order of the Illuminati as a front organization for the Jesuit order. The principles of the Illuminati were the principles of communism. Communism had been perfected by the Jesuit order on the reductions, which were communal farms in Paraguay in the 15th, 16th, and 17th centuries. Okay, so they perfected the principles of communism, the Jesuit order did. Adam Weishaupt then put those into an organization called the Illuminati. They ran a test run in the French Revolution to see how communist principles would be carried out in a modern nation like France. Then 50 years later, they got together two men, one by the name of Karl Marx, the other by the name of Engels, and they put Karl Marx's name to a book that had the principles of Jesuit communism into a book called The Communist Manifesto. And then those principles that came from the Jesuit order through Weishaupt and the Illuminati through Marx's book, The Communist Manifesto, were then tried out in the nations of Russia, China, Cambodia, Cuba, and other nations across this world. So folk, the bloodbaths of communism through the 19th and 20th centuries sits at the door of Rome. The papacy has created wars for their ends. They assassinate presidents and leaders who stand in their way. Here is just one book. Here is two books. Here is three books of just the few that I brought. Transformation of the Republic by C.T. Wilcox. The Truth Behind the Assassination of Abraham Lincoln. Charles Chiniqui's book, 50 Years in the Church of Rome. Chiniqui actually warned Lincoln three times. He said, "President Lincoln, they're going to kill you." Maybe this afternoon I'll tell you why Chiniqui and Lincoln were such good friends. And then this book by Justin Fulton called Lincoln's Assassination. Now I've got back home at least three other books that talk about the Catholic Church's role in Lincoln's assassination. And if you want to take a trip to Washington, D.C., don't forget to visit Ford's Theater in downtown Washington, D.C., because I went there a few years ago, and there is a spiral runway that goes down underneath Ford's Theater, and down underneath Ford's Theater there are several glass cases, and inside the cases are memorabilia from the Civil War and from the assassination of Lincoln. And it has pictures of the people that were involved in the conspiracy to assassinate Abraham Lincoln. And folk, all of the people were either Roman Catholics or connected to Roman Catholic organizations. John Wilkes Booth, who pulled the trigger, was a member of the Knights of the Golden Circle. Have you ever heard of the Knights of Columbus or the Knights of Malta? They're all Roman Catholic orders, as was John Wilkes Booth. Those who destroy business competition that dares to try and make a living. This is hate. This has been and is the papacy's plan always. But anybody that points a finger and says, you've done this, now they become the bad guy. Or they disappear. That folk is twisted, devilish insanity. Some people say there's no judgment going on. Well, but folk, the Bible says the Catholic Church has tried to obscure from vision the fact that after Jesus died, he went back to the sanctuary in heaven. Paul talks about it in Hebrews chapter 7 through 10, to minister for mankind before God. We don't have to go to an earthly priest. That's insanity. We go to Jesus Christ, the only mediator between God and man. Some people say there's no need for a judgment, that the Bible is very clear, began in 1844. Some people say, but I've accepted Christ. I don't need judgment. I don't know of any scholars that teach about that. Jesus never taught such ridiculous foolishness as that. Oh, yes, he did. Matthew 22, 11 to 14, the Bible says, the king came in to see the guests. He saw there a man which had not on a wedding garment, and he said to the man, friend, how camest thou in hither not having a wedding garment? He was speechless. Then said the king to the servants, bind him hand and foot and take him away and cast him into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen. When the king came in to see the guests, he examined everybody that had been invited to the wedding. He examined them. There's an examination going on, folks, in heaven today. And the decisions we make in our bodies, they're important. Every single one of them. By the king's examination of the guests at the feast is represented a work of judgment. The guests at the gospel feast are those who profess to serve God, whose names are written in the book of life. But not all who profess to be Christians are true disciples. Before the final reward is given, it must be decided who are fitted to share the inheritance of the righteous. This decision must be made prior to the second coming of Christ in the clouds of heaven. For when he comes, his reward is with him to give every man according as his work shall be. Revelation 22, 12. Before his coming, then, the character of every man's work will have been determined, and to every one of Christ's followers, the reward will have been apportioned according to his deeds. And somebody says, well, where did that come from? What's COL, page 310? Well, COL is the letters, the abbreviated letters for a book called Christ Object Lessons, written by a lady named Ellen White. And folk, here are two other books by the same author, The Desire of Ages, called by the Library of Congress the finest book ever written on the life of Christ. It's over there on the table for whoever would like this copy. This book right here is called The Great Controversy Between Christ and Satan. Folk, if you want to read what you read in your newspapers on a daily basis, this lady wrote about it over 100 years ago in this book. What she writes about in the chapter, it's called Liberty of Conscience Threatened. Liberty of Conscience Threatened. It sounds as though you are reading events from USA Today. Great book. Great, great books. The churches of today, our brethren in Christ, following the same God we are, preaching the same message we do, inviting anybody and everybody into our pulpits. Those who we should encourage to stay in their churches because we're all the same. Folks, that's what Rome wants us to believe. We're all the same. Everybody's the same. We all just love Jesus and we dress however we want and we eat however we want and we all go to church on Sunday. And everybody's the same and we just love each other until the time comes when Rome's going to send out her dragonades and massacre all the Protestants. Wake up. We better wake up. We better wake up. Let's kneel for prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for the beauty of your word that we as your children can understand it. Please forgive us for all the times when we have justified foolishness, when we have justified eating things that were horrible for us, when we have justified habitually sleeping at all hours of the night and saying, oh, it doesn't hurt me. Father, forgive us for our foolishness. Forgive us for our indolence. Forgive us for not being serious about the fact that we were made and that Jesus died in our behalf, that we are of infinite value in heaven's sight, and that the decisions we make as to how we care for ourselves, how we dress ourselves, what we believe, it is important. Father, I just pray that we'd make decisions today to say, Lord, I want to follow your plans. I want to do what you want me to do. I want to represent you in this world because you're my maker and my savior. Father, bless us to make that decision today, each one of us in our own heart and mind, that we're going to go forth from this place. We're going to trust you to change us into the people you want us to be. Strengthen each one of us and help us to use that wonderful gift of choice to that end. In Jesus' name, amen.